original followers followed Jesus, they didn't believe right away. On day one, that didn't happen. Belief came years, for some of them, years later. We'll talk about that in just a couple of weeks on Easter Sunday. But when they started, they began as what we call disciples. And disciples really just a student. There's somebody who's asking questions, they're learning. They're like an apprentice who's trying to figure out how to do something. They're following and they're like an adherent. Ooh, look at me, I'm on the screen. That's pretty sweet. Nobody starts out with belief. We begin by learning, by asking questions, by finding answers. And if we do end up believing, then it's important you know you can't stay there, because as great as belief is, there's more to Jesus than belief. And if you're new with us so far in our series, we've said that disciples do a few different things. They follow. They follow Jesus into the new thing that he came to do in the world and in us. And they learn what's true. They don't change the truth to bend around them. They actually learn what's true and they bend their lives around that so they grow. And they learn to gather in a brand new way and care for people in a brand new way and honor everyone, no matter what differences they had in common. That's unique in the world then and still in the world today. Disciples learned how to pray in such a way that brought the divine into the daily, into the ordinary, where we need it the most. And then, as we talked about last week, they learned how to be generous and give what God has put in our basket and be generous with that, because maybe, as I said last week, maybe all those eggs aren't there for us. And so this morning, I'd like to continue by talking about how Jesus led his disciples into a brand new way of loving others. And when we talk about love, it's a challenging conversation because we use the word love for so many different things, right? I mean, we love Chiefs. Can I get a witness? We love our Chiefs. I love Chinese food, all right? We love our favorite pair of stretchy pants, right, ladies? Come on. Your favorite pair of stretchy pants and slippers. We love our spouse, we love our kids, we love God. We use that word for everything, right? But what does it really mean? In our culture, it can mean so many different things. Is it a feeling? Is it an attachment to something? Is it passion? Is it desire? Is it conditional or unconditional? Is it based on what we give? Or is it based on what we get out of it? Is it a response that we have because somebody is making us feel a certain way? Does love go beyond all of that? See, when Jesus walked among us with his disciples, he helped them see something bigger and better when it came to love, because the disciples were a lot like us. When it came to love, love was all about you. It was all about, well, in this case, them, us, right? What they wanted, what they needed, their cares, their desires, their wants. It was a very self-satisfying and very self-serving kind of idea. They loved what they loved and who they loved and why they loved them and how they loved them. And all of that really had it itself, themselves at the center of it. And as long as whatever it was that they loved gave them what they wanted and needed, then they continued to love. But when any of that changed, so did their love. I mean, we can be like that too in our lives. We can love very selfishly, very conditionally. We love something or someone usually because it gives us something we want and need. We love it as long as it works for us. But the moment that it stops caring or giving or being there for us, we stop loving it. We stop showing care and love towards that or that thing or that person. We stop caring as much. I mean, the time that we get sick on our favorite food, come on, somebody, we stop loving it as much. When our favorite sports team let us down, right, we turn the channel. We stop caring as much. When our friends weren't there for us, we pulled back from them, didn't we? When our spouse or our kids did or do what they do or did, sometimes we can even be withholding our love from them because they're not giving me what I want. More often than any of us would care to admit, our love can depend on whether or not the thing or the person that we love is loving us back and giving us what we need. And in that sense, love is really all about you. For me, in this case, it's not always about the thing that we love or the person that we love as much as it is about us. But Jesus wanted something better and something bigger for us when it came to our understanding of love, especially for his disciples, because he knows our temptation as humans is to make our love all about us, getting what we want and what we need. And then if we do, then we'll love, then we'll show what we love. But when we don't get what we want, we're tempted to walk away, we're tempted to pull back, we're tempted to not care anymore. And so Jesus wants to help us trade the way that we love for the way God loves, where instead of love being all about you, we discover that God's love, or the love of Jesus in this case, is really all about the you next to you. So if you want to follow Jesus and be his disciple and become more like him, you've got to see more than just belief. And while it's important, you and I know God loves you and he sent his son to die for you, it's also just as equally important that you and I understand he feels the exact same way about every other person around you. And the way that he wants his perfect love to be demonstrated through you into the world is how you treat the people around you. So when it comes to love, he doesn't want your love to be about you, to be selfish, to be conditional. He wants it to be selfless and unconditional. He wants it to be about the you next to you. Or to put it another way, this is what I want you to walk away with today. Love will teach you how to put yourself second. It'll teach you. This will help your marriage. This will help you with your kids. This will help you at work tomorrow. This will help you with that cranky neighbor who's always yelling at you to get off their lawn. This will help you in your life. Love, the love that we're going to talk about today, teaches us how to put ourselves second and others first. Because disciples learn that love is not what we get out of it. It's what we give into it. It's not how we help ourselves to what we want. It's how we help others and give them what they need. It's not about you. It's about the you next to you. Love puts self second. So to help his disciples really understand that, Jesus needed to teach them and expand their thinking and idea about what love really was. So on one occasion, he said to them, you've heard that it was said, you've love your neighbor and hate your enemy. This is what they were raised with, right? Do unto others as, you know, they would do unto you. Kind of treat the ones that love you with love, and the ones that don't love you, don't love them, right? That's a common sense kind of thing. But Jesus says, I want to tell you something different. Love even your enemies. We talked a little bit about this last week. Pray for those who persecute you, because when you do, you may be children of your Father in heaven, who loves unconditionally, because he causes his son to rise even on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. What's he saying? God blesses those who don't give a rip about him. Because if you only love those who love you, what reward will you get? Aren't even those tax collectors, those traitors, in other words, those people who could care less, don't they do that? And if you greet only those who love you or people who are like you, your own people, what are you doing more than anybody else? Don't even the pagans, the unbelievers do that? You need to be perfect in your love as your heavenly Father is perfect. Can you imagine how difficult it would have been that day to hear Jesus say these things? So right away, they're feeling the tension of how God's love is very different than the way we love. We love conditionally with our own self-interest in mind. We love when it's easy. We love when we're getting what we want. We love when we're being loved. But God loves everyone perfectly, equally, and unconditionally. Regardless of whether that person loves God back or not, God loves them and does good to them. His love isn't about what he gets out of it. It's what he can give to them. It's not what helps him and makes him better. It's what helps us and makes our lives better. God causes his love and his good gifts to bless even those who could care less about him. Isn't that amazing? He loves because his love helps people. And by loving and doing loving and good things, he helps people who don't even care about him, because love always helps others. And that's why Jesus wants us to love others like him, not because love is required as a follower of Jesus, as one of his disciples, but because love is the best way to live. It's the most helpful way to live. It gives others what they need from us when we can give it to them. It helps their lives get better. It helps your spouse. It helps your kids. It helps your coworkers. When you love, you are more apt to help and serve and give than you are to take. and make it all about you. We are to love people because it helps people and because people need it and because God loves that way. That's why Jesus tells his disciples to love those who don't even care about them. Love those who are your enemies. Love those who make life difficult for you. Pray for those who persecute you. Do good to those who don't do good to you, because this is the way God loves. And then this sort of love is hard. It's selfless. It's not easy. You can't do it on your own. But if you tap into the kind of love God has, you can do this, and it will help their life get better. And it will also help your life and your relationships. When you love people like this, you are becoming children of your Father in heaven. But if you only love those who love you, or who love those who are easy to love, or just give to those who might give back to you, then that's not the same. That's not the love that God has. Because love isn't about you. It's about the you next to you. The way of love is a selfless way, and it leverages who you are and what you have to care for and love and support and give to those around you in need. But Jesus is also helping us see something else here about what love is. He's connecting our love for God with our love for people, for others. He wanted his disciples, don't miss this, to understand that you cannot say you love God if you don't love the people God has put in your life. You cannot say that you love God if you don't love the people God has created in his own image and put around you in your daily life. Jesus' disciples grew up thinking like what a lot of us probably grew up thinking. And if you grew up in church, you grew up thinking like this, like I did, that it didn't matter how you treated people as long as you were good with God. Right? What mattered more was whether or not you were following the rules and whether you and God were good. Loving God trumped everything. So as long as you did what you needed to do and you went to church and you read your Bible and you prayed every day, who cares how you treat anybody else? And this is a struggle for a lot of people, because loving God seems to be the priority. A lot of people still live their life like that, treating people however they want as long as they follow the rules. You ever met somebody like that? But Jesus wanted us to correct that kind of thinking. So at another moment, he leverages this teaching he was having with his disciples to help them see that you can't say you love God if you don't love those around you, the people that God has made. So Jesus says, I want you to understand that if you're offering your gift at the altar in the temple there in Jerusalem, if you're bringing your gift here to make a sacrifice, and you remember while you're standing in line that your brother or sister has something against you, I want you to leave your gift, and I want you to go. Leave it, go, get out of line, go, and be reconciled to your brother or your sister, and then come and back and offer your gift here at the temple. Now, most Jewish people growing up in Jesus' day made it a habit to go to the temple in Jerusalem and offer sacrifices for their sins. And this was so important to them. Making things right with God was more important than whether or not somebody back home was upset with them, or maybe upset with them. For most of these Jewish people who were there offering sacrifices, they didn't even live in the area. And so they would have to travel to Jerusalem, sometimes between 2 to 3 days' journey, one direction, just to get there to make sacrifices. So what Jesus was saying wasn't just not important to them, but it wasn't practical for them. There was just no way that people would give up their spot in line at the temple, go home and look for someone who might be upset or offended with us, then return and make offering and sacrifice at the temple again. The offended party would just have to wait, because making things right with God was more important. But Jesus is saying something you have to hear. He's saying that making things right with that person is how you make things right with God. It's just as important, maybe even more important, than making a sacrifice to God. Let's put it in our own translation, than reading your Bible, or than praying, or than going to church. Making things right with people is more important than doing all the things you need to do to be close and right with God. Loving people is how you show you really love God. Making things right with that person determines whether or not things are going to be right with God. They thought that the only thing that mattered was the vertical, whether they were loving God and following the rules. But Jesus was telling them the horizontal determines the vertical. You can't be right with God unless you're right with people. You can't love God unless you're loving people. And this was a teaching that Jesus came back to regularly throughout his ministry, over and over and over again, to help them realize the depth and the reality of what love would require and what love would ask of them. And it would, he would bring it up often every day. One day he was even asked this question, "Teacher, what's the greatest commandment in the law?" Like, what's the most important rule, right? We know the Ten Commandments, maybe. And if you didn't know that out of those Ten Commandments, the Jewish nation created 630 more laws, right? So they had all these rules to follow. What's the most important rule, like Jesus? What's the greatest? And he replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment." And it was. And that was what every Jewish person had grown up hearing and obeying. It was from the Old Testament Jewish scriptures, the book of Deuteronomy. It was known as the Shema statement. It's a statement about who God is and what God deserves. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your strength." Every Jewish person was raised on the Shema statement. The Lord our God is one. And he should be loved with all of our hearts, our souls, and our strength. So he was right. Jesus was right. It was the greatest, and it was the first. But he didn't stop there. He continued. "And the second is like it," not in significance, but in importance. Everyone knew there was one great commandment. Jesus used this as an opportunity to leverage and help them see what love really looks like for God. "And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself." All the law, all the prophets, all of what is written in the Old Testament Jewish scriptures hang on these two commands that are really one command. And if you had asked anybody standing there that day, including Jesus' own disciples, what it looked like to love God, they would have all said, "Obey God, follow the rules." That's the vertical answer. But Jesus suggested a horizontal answer, love your neighbor. And his point is so clear and so unmistakable. If you're loving your neighbor, you're obeying God. If you're loving your neighbor, you're following the law. If you're loving your neighbor, you're living faithful to the rules. Because love for God is best demonstrated by loving one's neighbor. You can't say you love God if you don't love your neighbor. So that means, listen, anybody who mistreats a person made in the image of God, anybody who mistreats a neighbor, who doesn't love a neighbor, can't say they love God. So from this point forward, Jesus is making his point unmistakably clear. No disciple will ever be able to say that they love God if they don't show love to the people around them. Now, love for others proves your love for God. And that's very different than what they had grown up thinking, or that I grew up thinking, or maybe you grew up experiencing. Maybe you've experienced people who in your life say they love God, but they didn't love you. In fact, they hurt you, and they caused you pain. Jesus never wanted that in his name or for his church. And he always has wanted his disciples to love people in a bigger and a better way. He's always wanted our love for God to lead us to love others so well that even if people don't agree with us or believe like we believe, they will at least admire the way we love. They will see in our lives how we put self second and others first. How we make our life and our love not all about us, but about them and about him. Jesus wants the way that we love people to be how they see the love of God in their life. That's why Jesus helped his disciples realize this. He said, everybody is your neighbor. Those who are like you, those who aren't, those who believe like you and those who don't, those who you get along with and those who you can't stand, the people who voted on the other side of the aisle than you, all of them are your neighbors. Love them. And this is still hard to do. Everyone is our neighbor, and everyone deserves love, no matter who they are or what we have in common. Disciples who follow Jesus should love people like God loves them, unconditionally and equally, because we understand that loving them is evidence of love for him. And if we know him in his heart, let me tell you, it's not hard to love people, even when they're difficult, even when they're your enemy, even when they make your life hard. Because if you can see people, not as how they make you feel, but as how God loves them and created them and how God sees them, it's much easier to love them when it's not about you. And it's all about how God has created them. I pray every day, God, help me see people like you see people so I don't treat them the way that I feel. Because I'm just like you, tempted to, believe me, I defend myself. I want to stand up for myself. So when I feel like my life is being attacked and I need to defend it, I want to lash back out. But Jesus has helped me love even the hardest people because I can see through me and how I feel to who God created and what they need. But the question remains for those original disciples and even for us. But if that determines our love for God, how we love others, and how should we love? What should we do? How should we love them, Jesus? And Jesus would answer that question for his disciples. In an upper room, the night before he would go to the cross, he would display for them what God's love really looks like, what God's love really requires of us, what God's love would ask of us every day. When you want to know how to love your neighbor, when you want to know how to love your spouse, when you want to know how to love your kids and that coworker, when you want to know what it looks like to love, Jesus says, I want you, a new command I'm giving you. I want you to love everyone as I have loved you. When you want to know what love looks like, I want you to remember my life. I want you to remember how I talk to people. And they had watched for 3.5 years Jesus do some incredible things and care about people and honor people and love people and be generous to people. But that night, when he gave that command, the next day he would be hanging on a cross. What they had seen for 3.5 years was nothing compared to what they were about to see. Love others like I have loved you. Do what I have done. Live as I have lived. And when Jesus was hanging up on that cross, they could see for themselves how he put himself second and how he put the needs of others first. Love wasn't about him and what he wanted and what he could get out of it. It was about us. It was about what we needed and how he could help. And God could do something about what we could do nothing about. And he leveraged who he was and what he had to serve us. Love wasn't about him. It wasn't about you when it came to Jesus. It was about the you next to you. You and me on that cross. It was about us. And that's why his last instruction to his disciples the night before was, love them like I have loved you. By this kind of love, this selfless, sacrificial, give yourself up kind of love. When you don't make it about you, but you make it about them. When you ask the question every day, what does love require of me? What do I need to do to get second in line and put them first? When you ask that question and you live with that kind of love, the entire world will know that you are my disciple if you love one another. Because there's nothing greater in your life that you can commit to, that you can devote yourself to, than to live a life like this, because greater love has no one than this. If you would willingly lay down your life and take second place for somebody to be first. And there's nothing greater that you and I could do than to love like this. So if you want to know what it looks like to love like Jesus, love says, give yourself up. Put yourself second. Make it about them. Don't make it about you. Don't help yourself. Don't serve yourself. Help them. Serve them. Love requires something of you. It asks something of you. It isn't about you. It's about the you next to you. It puts self second and others first. And this was the brand new command that Jesus gave to every single disciple, because his primary concern isn't that you would just believe something about him. Belief is important, sure, but there's more than belief. Jesus wants his disciples to do something because of that belief. Continue loving people like I have loved them. And after watching what Jesus did for them out of love on the cross with the spit of Roman soldiers and the dirt of the Jerusalem streets mixed with his blood and with his sweat hanging on a tree, they got a picture of what love really looks like, of what it asked, of what it requires, of how it pushes us back and others first. To demonstrate love like that meant that you got to put the people next to you in front of you. Just like Jesus did. And it's going to be different for every person. You have to ask yourself every day, what does love ask of me? How do I love them? What does love require of me? How do I put them in front of me? How do I make it more about them than me? This will change your life. This will change your marriage. This will change your family. This will change your workplace. I'm telling you, this will change everything. But it has the potential to change your heart and your eternity. They saw with their own eyes what Jesus was willing to do because of love and how God's love was so much greater and bigger. And Jesus invites his disciples to live this way. And all of them followed his example. And we don't have time to walk through each of their stories, but each of them in their own way and in their own lives lived and continued loving like Jesus did. One by one, they served others. They cared for people. They met needs. They prayed for each other. They touched the untouchable. They walked towards the broken and the messes. They were willing to serve and care. They leveraged all of who they were and all of what they had to help those around them, each of them, every day. And in the end, when it came to their time, each of them, out of selfless, sacrificial love, because of God's love for them, were willing to lay down their own lives for others. Every single one of those disciples listening to Jesus that night before he went to the cross would die a martyr's death and serve and give up their lives for those around them out of love. And the reason why they did it, why they loved this way, was because Jesus loved them this way, and it changed everything. And his way of love asked them to do something with what they believed about him. Disciples obey Jesus' command to love others because they see and were experiencing Jesus' love first. And when you taste and see the love of God for you and for me, it will set you free from selfishness. It will set you free from a prison of making life and love all about you. And you will be free to see what love really looks like and what love really does and how it is so helpful for the world and the people around you. We love not because we have to. We love because we get to, and we were loved by God, which means that we continue loving people like Jesus. And that's why we love. It's the sacrificial love of Jesus that motivates us. We love because we don't have to, because it's a rule we follow, because you're supposed to do it as a Christian. You love because you get a chance to. You love because you get an opportunity to, and you can't wait to help others know the goodness and the love of God that you have experienced yourself. Our love will help them feel and see God's love. You can make the people around you, their life, better or worse by the way you treat them, by the way you love them, by the way you speak to them, by the way you listen to them, the way you live among them. And if love is what we all needed most from God, listen, friends, it's what others need most from you. It's the only way they're going to see something better about God than what they've experienced in their past. If they see in you something different. That's what motivated the early disciples. Because of what they believed, they were motivated to do something. Really quick, just a couple of examples. Like the Apostle Paul, in response to the love of God, he says we should be doing something in response to this. So because of God's love for us, we should get rid of all bitterness and all rage and all anger and all brawling and all slander, along with every kind of evil or malice. He says the love of God should lead us to be kind to others and compassionate to others, even forgiving each other. Oh, that's a great idea, Paul, but what would motivate us to do that? Why would we do that? Why would we forgive someone? Why would we get rid of anger and bitterness and rage? What would motivate us to do that and love others that way after they've hurt us, after they've wounded us, after they've betrayed us, after they've offended us? Why should we be kind to the unkind? Forgiveness is a gift to the guilty. Why would I give them a gift? Why would I love like this? Because this kind of love, not only does it help people, but it's just like what Jesus gave you. So follow God's example as dearly loved children. Walk, he says, in this way of love. Don't treat them like their sins deserve, because God didn't treat you like your sins deserved. Instead, he loved you. Treat them like Jesus has treated you. Love them like God has loved them, and it will help their life. For love them just as Christ loved you and gave himself up as an offering and a sacrifice. So you should live your life like that. Paul makes it so clear that love gives itself up. It doesn't make life about us. Puts others first. Disciples' behavior, your behavior tomorrow at work, should be patterned and modeled after Christ's. That's the standard that we have to hold ourselves to. Peter even goes further, one of the other disciples, and he tells us that God's love, if we've been forgiven, if you've been cleansed from your sins, you should now show that kind of love sincerely to everybody. Love deeply from your heart because you've been born again. Something has happened, something has changed, and because of that, it should cause something different to happen in your life. You should treat the people around you differently because of how God has treated you. If you have benefited from God's love and grace, why aren't you giving more of that away? Because Peter is saying what Paul was saying. It's not about you. It's about you, next to you. You're responsible to give away everything God has given to you. Paul would even add to that and say, you guys, you want to know the only thing that matters. If you strip it all down, the only thing that matters, the only thing that counts is your faith expressing itself through love. The only thing, like Jesus said, love the Lord your God, love your neighbor. I want to tell you how that plays out in your life. The only thing that matters is whether or not your faith in God is expressing itself through daily acts of love for those around you. The only way, the only thing that matters. That's a huge statement from the great apostle Paul, is faith expressing itself through love. So in this sense, love is really just faith in action. It's just faith in action. Our faith in God is proven by our love for others. This is a new way of love. It's revolutionary. It was revolutionary for Jesus' disciples. It's still revolutionary for us today. John was one of Jesus' closest disciples, but he probably said it best when he said that, friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Where did it come from? God. We wouldn't know what it's like. We wouldn't understand it or experience its benefits without God having sent his son. So love comes from God. Everybody who loves has been born of God and knows God. But whoever doesn't love doesn't know God, because God is love. He identifies God this way. He says this again, God is love, and whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. And we love not because we have to, but because we were loved first by him. So if you claim to love God, but yet you hate your brother or sister, you're a liar. Whoever does not love cannot love God. John says it so eloquently. We all can say that we love God, and we can sing songs to him, and we can attend church, and we can read our scriptures, but if we mistreat any of his kids, we have a problem with our Father in heaven. We can't say we love God if we don't love people. Every person, no matter who they are or what they are like or different from you. Disciples know this, that everybody is somebody that God loves. Everybody is somebody that God loves. Remember that when you are frustrated. Remember that when you are angry. Remember that when you are offended and hurt and you are mad. Everybody, your spouse, your kids, come on, your boss. I didn't get an amen on that one. I was curious about that. But, you know, your boss as well. Everybody is somebody that God loves. Disciples love everyone. And if we just love people more like God has loved us, then wouldn't we see a lot of the messes around us get better? I mean, can you imagine a world where people might be skeptical of what we believe as followers of Jesus, but they're envious of how we treat each other? Wouldn't it be amazing if they didn't believe, but they wanted to work with us or work for us or live in our neighborhood or on our street or our kids play together? I mean, because of the way we treat, that's what Jesus has always wanted for his followers, for us to love in a revolutionary kind of way and continue the way of love that he began. Maybe they'll see God's love for them through our love. But somewhere along the way, we've just made love more about us. Less like what Jesus has lived like and more like what we want. We put ourselves at the center of love, made it about my desires and my needs. It's come about me or you, not about the you next to you. And Jesus wants to help us all love in a bigger way and a better way, and to love others in the same way that God loves us. So if everybody is somebody that God loves, then my question to each of us this morning before I pray is, are you loving the you next to you like God? The you right now next to you. The you next to you tonight and tomorrow. When it comes to all of those people that God has put in your life, are you putting yourself second? Or are you putting yourself first? Problems come when you do that. But if you were making it about them, I guarantee you a lot of your problems would go away. According to John, according to Paul, according to Peter, and according to Jesus, loving people is just like loving God. So if you and I loved others like this more, then it would not just change our lives, but it would have the potential to change their life. When we've received that, we should give that. And this kind of idea, this kind of love, you know, our love for others has the potential to bring freedom to somebody's life that needs God's freedom. You want to ask, how does that work, Jason? How does my love for them bring spiritual freedom for them? When you love people like Jesus loves them, you won't sin against them. You won't hurt them. You won't cause them pain. You won't do anything to bring shame or regret into their life, because love for them will motivate you to do nothing that will harm, hurt, or sin against someone that God loves and has made in his image. You want to know why you shouldn't lie to people? Not because it's just wrong or bad, but because you love them. Why would you lie to somebody that God died for? Why shouldn't you gossip about somebody? Why shouldn't you slander them or mistreat them? Or if you're in a relationship, why shouldn't you sexually pressure somebody? Why don't you steal from somebody? Why don't you hurt them or offend them? Why do we not do those kinds of things? Simple. Because God loves them. And because I love them, I refuse to do anything that will cause them harm or hurt or pain. Disciples know that if I mistreat God's kids, then I've got a problem with God. And sin, really, all it is about us. It's about what we want. It's getting our way. It's not God's way. Sin is about you. You and you alone. Love is about the you next to you. And if you can live your life motivated by God's love for others, you will not do sinful, hurtful, painful things against them. Disciples just refuse to do anything in their life that will cause or be a part of the shame and the regret that somebody experiences. When they think of their greatest pain, I love what Andy Stanley says, when they think of their greatest regrets or pains, they shouldn't think of me. God loves them, and he wants us to love them. And if we just loved others more like Jesus, it would not only change our life, it would change their lives. And that's what I want to invite you to this morning as we pray, as the worship team comes. God's asking you to love those around you. I don't know who they are. I don't know how difficult it is. I don't know the challenges that comes to that. But there are people all around you right now who need you to love them like God. And if you can do that, I promise you, God will help you and their life. But maybe that's a struggle for you. Maybe that's something that you have no idea how to do. That's because you haven't yet experienced the love of God for your life. And I want to introduce you to this kind of love that Jesus has for you. We're told that because God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in him wouldn't perish, spiritually die, spend eternity separated from God, but they would have eternal life. And he didn't send his Son into the world to condemn it, to tell you how bad you are or what you should be doing differently. He came and he sent his Son into the world to save it, because you were worth it and because he loves you. So Lord, right now I pray, before we leave and go our week, that if there's anyone listening online or here in person who has not responded to your invitation of mercy and love and grace, that right now in this moment that they would accept that you are the God who sent his Son, who lived a perfect life and died a death that we deserve for our sin. You didn't do anything to deserve it, but because you were willing to love us, you sent your Son to the cross to pay the punishment of our own sins. And your death and resurrection from the dead, Jesus, is the catalyst. It's the action. It is the motivation that can allow spiritual change to occur when we put our faith in you, when we trust in you. You can forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness and make us and restore us to be right with God. I pray that somebody would right now in this moment say, Jesus, I need you. I ask you to forgive me and be the Savior of my life. I pray that somebody experiences the love of God today for the first time. And I pray that all of us, if we've heard this message before, been challenged by these things before in our lives, that we would be reminded of the incredible love that you have for us. And that you would motivate and challenge us to love others in our lives like Jesus, you have loved us. Because as a disciple, there's so much more than belief. God, we want to love the world like you have loved us. Help us to do that. Give us wisdom to know how to do it. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. Be back here next Sunday as we continue our conversation on Palm Sunday. Have a great week. God bless. We love you.